going to just go down through this line by line, verse by verse. James, the first chapter. Michael's also going to have it up on the screen. Why don't we start by reading the first verse? There's so much in God's Word if we just take the time to look at it. James, a bondservant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greetings. Such a simple introduction statement. But I want us to see, first of all, here's a man that was well known. He could have addressed himself as this prophet, the top guy. You know what I'm saying? He could have really blown his own horn. Hey, I'm the dude that everybody knows that has it all, the wisdom, the knowledge that's come from God. But how did he address himself? A bondservant of the Lord Jesus. He said, I willfully am a slave, a servant of God. And I've had people, we're not slaves of God. The Bible says that you've been bought with a price. You're not your own. And that's the New Testament. That's not Old Testament. We do not own ourselves. I love this attitude. Right off the bat, he sets the tone by saying, I am a humble, willful servant of the Lord God. And then he begins to teach about what that means. What does it mean to really be a bondservant? To be someone that willfully serves God? He gets right into the meat. I love James because he doesn't mess around. And I'm not picking on any of the other books. I'm just saying he just jumps right into it. I'm a meat and taters guy. Anybody knows me? I'll eat the salad, but I want to get right to the meat and taters. You hear me? I came home last night, and one of the people that were staying and watching Becca as we were over at the staff retreat had made a big old roast. Ooh. Dave, you a roast guy? I'm a roast guy, man. And they seasoned it really well. And my lady does a great roast. But I had to text the person and tell them how delicious. I'm a meat and taters guy. So let's get in the meat and taters. He immediately starts telling them how to be a bondservant. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Wow. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces what? Patience. How many, when things are going tough in your life, I'm not saying when we've made stupid decisions that bring about repercussions, when we have junk coming against us, when we're trying our best to live for God, do the right thing, and we just feel like the forces of hell are just trying to knock us down, attack us, beat us down, how many of us feel like jumping for joy? It actually means be hilarious, be excited when you're going through junk, Trish. Now again, I'm not saying when we're making stupid, ungodly decisions and dealing with the repercussions, that's a whole nother lesson. When we're trying our best to live for God and do what's right, and this junk just keeps coming at us, how many want to jump for joy? And yet, it's absolutely imperative that we learn to maintain this attitude. And then he says, let me tell you why. First of all, as we endure, as we make it through this, patience happens. Patience are grown. They're stretched. Right? The trying or the testing of your faith produces patience. And godly patience is so important. Look at verse number 4. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. So, if on this process of maturity in Christ, it's absolutely imperative, totally necessary, that we let patience grow in us, then what do we have to do to get patience? Endure testing, trials, temptation. It's kind of like if Eddie wants to be, you know, muscle man, and he wants to bench 400 pounds, okay, in order to do that, he's got to go through a lot of, right? And it starts out sometimes a little weaker, and then it gets stronger and stronger and stronger, and he learns to do more reps with more weight. But if he doesn't make it through that, he doesn't endure that. In other words, the first time he starts working out, if he just throws a couple half up and then he just quits, is he going to become the muscle man that he's supposed to be? And so what is James trying to tell us? If we want to really be a bondservant, if we want to be someone that's being effective at serving God, we don't need to just have trials come into our lives, but we need to make it through them victoriously. But what really happens for most of us is, as soon as things get tough, we, Lord, get me out of here! Lord! Lord! You hear me? Again, I'm not talking about going out and doing something stupid and having repercussions. That's a whole nother thing. He says, don't do the stupid stuff and you won't have those repercussions. Right? I'm talking about when we're trying to move forward and do our best for God, and yet the enemy's attacking, junk's coming against us. And even if we do make stupid decisions and the repercussions come, Father still doesn't want us to give up and quit or be condemned. He wants us to move forward, make right decisions, right? But endure. It's so important that we learn the trying of our faith produces patience, and patience, if we allow it by the Holy Spirit, will mature us in Christ, will make us muscle men and women for Jesus. Make sense? Sorry, guys, I'm just shooting at the cuff here. But it's important, right? This is His Word. We're learning His Word. We're stretching. Let's look at 5 through 8. And I've read this many times, but I'm going to read it again. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. First of all, God wants us to endure. God wants us to grow. God wants to develop patience in us, and it's necessary in order for us to mature and reach what He wants us to reach in Him. He also wants every one of us to have the wisdom that only flows from God. But, we need to come to Him with the right heart attitude. Right? We need to really want His wisdom. Not half-hearted, not half-minded, but totally and completely sold out and willing to implement what He wants to give. You hear me? Well, I've heard about that. I don't know. You know, I'm still thinking I might want to stay with that. Well, I don't know. Yeah, I might try it. We come to God half-heartedly and double-minded, and the Bible tells us we're not going to receive anything. In fact, we're unstable in all areas if we have that mindset. And so we need to decide. Lord, I want Your wisdom. The Bible says He seeks and He desires us to what? Worship Him in spirit and in truth. God wants us to have an honest, open heart. I'm not saying that we might not have things where we're unsure. That's why we're asking for wisdom. I'm saying when we come to Him, we need to come to Him honestly and open with a pure heart. Really desiring help. Does that make sense? How many have ever wanted to impart wisdom to your kids, but you found out it's absolutely worthless if their heart attitude's wrong? See? But when they come to us, you know, about 20, 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 or some 30, and all of a sudden you see this huge change. They go from thinking they know everything to really being interested in what you have to say. It's a change of the heart. They go out there and live a little bit, and they realize they're not nearly as smart as they think they are. I'm not picking on our kids, but you know what I'm saying? And all of a sudden they come back and go, "Dad, what should I do about this and this and this?" And it just blesses your heart. And all of a sudden, just a couple words spoke to them, Therese, makes all the difference, because they're willing to receive it. That's what this is saying. Don't come to God half-heartedly. Come to Him willing and really wanting to know what He's got to sell, what He's got to give us, right? And if we will, then we'll receive it. See, in order to receive anything, if Julie goes to hand me something, I got to be willing to receive it, or it's going to fall on the ground, right? But He's sitting there, Randy, going, "Here, Randy, but you got to reach out and not just take it, but be willing to receive it and put it in a place." Make sense? That's our God. And if we won't do that, if we come to Him double-minded, it says not only will we not receive from Him, it's not saying He doesn't want to give it, it's saying we won't receive it. But it also says that if we have that kind of an attitude, that it actually brings instability to all areas of our lives. But what I love also about the reverse of that is if I start to press forward, and maybe I know very little about God, but I just start to come to Him humbly. "Lord God, I want, I need, I desire." And what happens is that unstable man begins to stabilize in this area. And then it spreads to this area and this area. You hear me? I was so broken as I went through my divorce. I'd made all this money and I was just so sure of myself, and all of a sudden I was losing everything, and it seemed like every inch of my life was coming apart. And all I could do was just cry out to God. And all of a sudden, stability started to form here, and then here, and then here, and then here. You hear me? And it took some time. Because how many know it takes time to build a good foundation? Doesn't it, Ron? It takes time. You hear me? You got to dig the hole, and it's got to be just right. Just, you know what I mean? In fact, these big skyscrapers, I read one day that Roy, they have to take the foundation to the bedrock. And sometimes those skyscrapers are 300-400 feet in the ground, the foundations are, because they got to get down to the bedrock. How many know that takes time? It takes effort. If your family's unstable, if your life's unstable, okay, just know that you can make a decision by God's power and grace right now to change that, to move forward. Amen? And right now, He'll start to build a solid foundation. And it's going to take some time, and it's going to take some effort. But if we'll endure, remember what James said? If we'll endure and let patience grow us. Boy, you wouldn't even recognize who I was in the year 2000. You wouldn't. First of all, I'd have been, every other word was the F-bomb. I was working with a bunch of contractors. I'm not in any way giving glory to the enemy. I'm saying, if Satan's saying, "I can't do that, I could never be a holy man," he's just a liar. You, by the power and grace of God, can change. You can be healed. I don't care what's happened to you. I can't. God wants to deliver and change you. I had someone that was making all these excuses because they had been mistreated as a child. And you know what I said? I started getting raped when I was 8 years old. 8 years old. So what I'm saying is the Bible says you can help others find healing and deliverance by what you've endured. I look back and I don't think for 1 second God wanted me to be raped at 8. But I can help people. I can relate to them. I can help them move forward because of how God healed me. See? God wants to change us all. He's an awesome God. But we got to be willing to come to Him and be honest. Lord, I need You. I can't do it. Amen? Father, heal me, deliver me. And then, see, be willing. We got to let Him flip that mind. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. All right, we're just running here as we go, one verse at a time. 9 through 11 says, let the lowly brother glory in his exaltation, but the rich in his humiliation, because as a flower of the field, he will pass away. For no sooner is the sun risen and a burning heat, then it withers the grass. A flower falls and its beautiful appearance perishes. So the rich man will also fade away in his pursuits. This is really, well, there's lots of things here. But the real thing I want us to see is we need to make sure our focus is correct. Right? I got a new bow. I didn't buy it, but somebody really blessed me around Christmas time. I admit I was feeling a little bit like, because everybody was getting presents and I wasn't getting any. And I admit it. I was feeling a little bit like, you know, dad's, I wanted my grandbabies and even my wife. I bought her bear boots, you know, I mean, we didn't have much money. I was feeling just a little bit, you know, I was whining a little bit to God. And then I shut my mouth, and I just began to press in, and I said, Lord, He showed me the blessing one day as I was standing here in front of the congregation of all these people. They're loving God moving forward, and then all my grandbabies and my family loving the Lord, and I was like, sorry, God, sorry. I'm such an idiot sometimes. Man, most of my babies are living for Jesus. What a blessing. Amen? What a blessing. You know, I got through that, and I was thanking Him, and anyway, literally a day or two later, my brother-in-law shows up and he's got a $1,000 bow. And, you know, I mean, used, they're $600-$700, you know, and I mean, it had a $300 sight on it and all this fancy stuff. And he just shows up and he gives it to me. Amen. And I mean, praise God. But, you know, at the age of almost 57, I throw that sight up sometimes, and I'm honest with you, I got, you know, really good sight, 20/20, but the reading glasses are necessary now. And so I throw it up, and it's out of focus. You know what I mean? I can't see the pins because they're just so close. I can see the animal just fine, but the pins are kind of blurry. But he spent a bunch of money, and he got this special, it's legal in Oregon, optical zoom lens on the sight. Man, I throw that up, and it's just, I mean, it's money. You hear me? And what I'm trying to say is my focus has been changed so I can see. And that's what we need. He's trying to say money's not where it's at. And we're going through stuff and we might even be losing some of our riches or whatever. Realize riches is not where it's at. So when you're going through junk, because he's been talking about going through junk, focus on the end game, His kingdom. Jesus said, don't lay your treasure up where? Here. But instead, there. Amen? Eddie, we're going to be dead a lot longer than we're going to be alive. Amen? So what's important? This little teeny time that we're actually living here on earth or eternity? Both. You see? Because how we live echoes for eternity. Both. And when we keep that focus, it changes everything. Amen? So every day, we need to look through the lens of God instead of the lens of Rick. Amen? We need to focus. Praise the Lord. All right, let's drop down because it's almost there. Let's go 22 through 25. This really kind of sums it all up. 22 through 25. but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. How many can relate to that? If I sat through a seminar, well, that's probably not a good one, because most of us wouldn't want to do that, even if our life depended on it. But if we sat through a seminar about how to do our own taxes, nah, forget that one. Okay. If we sat, well, that probably wouldn't relate to most of us, but let's say, okay, simple one. We learned how to change our own oil filter and change our own plugs. Because even if you're guys, we can relate to that. I'm saying we all learned how to do that, right? All of us. But we didn't apply any of it. We didn't pay attention. We didn't do anything, right? If we just heard what the guy was saying, but we didn't put it into practice, it wouldn't benefit us. Make sense? You know, especially if oil changes were $300 instead of $18.95 or $39.95. But if Isaac needed an oil change and it was $300, and he could sit through a little seminar and learn how to do it in about 15 minutes, if he listened, but he didn't put it into application, would it benefit him? No. And so James starts out at the end here by saying, everything I'm telling you, I want you to know that if you don't apply it, you're not going to receive any benefits. Make sense? Just like he said, a double-minded man is not going to receive anything from God. So the key to all of God's word is not just being a bench warmer, not just being somebody that sits here on Sunday or when you're in your quiet time, you read it, but actually putting it into practice. And how many know that one of the things that scares us from putting God's word into practice is that very word, practice? You see, which implies the fact that we don't start out perfect in whatever we're trying to do. Amen? We practice it. We're practicers. In fact, Paul says, practice to perfect. To perfection, to maturity. And so, first of all, we got to get in our minds the fact that we're practicers. Right? We have to practice what God says. And then eventually, as we keep on, right, we'll do better and better and better. But one thing I told my kids from an early age was this. Practice does not make perfect. That's a misnomer. Perfect practice makes perfect. Does that make sense? In other words, if we say, do the same dumb thing over and over and over, it's still going to be dumb 20 times later, right? Right? So we have to make corrections by the Holy Spirit. But as we do, amen? Then he brings us out of these places of hurt. We go back and we renew relationships. We put to death this junk the enemy's tried to kill us with an attack. You hear me? And we move forward and we mature. That's what these classes next week are going to be about. We're going to move forward. We're going to learn what New Beginnings is about, what we believe. We're going to talk about how we can come together as a team and be healed and change. And it's going to take some time and effort. But we're going to become a united team, a force that's doing not just a part, but we're doing together what we should be doing. Make sense? All right. Sorry, guys. All right, so let's read down through it. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourself. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror, for he observes himself and he goes away and he immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty, right here, the Word of God, and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man, this person, this one will be blessed in what he does. How many of you want to be blessed by God daily? That's the key. not just being a doer, a hearer, but a doer. Amen? And when we do that, then God will use us to accomplish His will. Amen? And He will begin to change this so that we flow in His will, because that's the key. Not getting Him to do what we want, but learning to do what He wants by His grace and power. Amen? And as we learn to abide in Him, and His words abide in us, the Bible says that what we begin to pray will start to happen, because we'll pray in line with His word and His will in faith. Make sense? Praise His name. Can we give Him a clap? Thank You, Father, for what You're doing right here in this group. Lord, help us to leave. Let's sing one song, can we? Before we leave, let's help us, Lord God, to leave here with the correct heart. Amen? Lord, help us to be doers. Help us, Lord, to desire to be bond servants, totally and completely committed to Your will by Your Holy Spirit. Change us, Father, at the core. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And we all agree by saying, amen, amen, amen.